Hello, everyone.
Hello.
It's fantastic to see so many people here representing Jesus in the world, in our lives. And tonight, you're going to see something special. You're going to see a time where Jesus spent with his disciples in a very intimate moment, a moment of reflection, a moment of instruction, and a moment of love. So as we come together this evening to witness this living Last Supper and to take Jesus out into the world, let's start things off with a prayer. Would you pray with me, please? Heavenly Father, Lord, as we get ready tonight just to bask in your glory and give our hearts to you, Lord, I pray that your Holy Spirit, your Spirit, would come into us and show us, Lord, your love and your grace and your mercy. And Lord, as we watch these people up here give a performance of what you did with your disciples, I pray that we would truly understand deeper than ever before your Last Supper. The supper with his disciples and sending them out. Lord, we praise your holy name. We lift you up and we worship and we praise your holiness. All these things, Father, and we do this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
I'm going to invite you to stand. We're going to sing. You know, I don't know about you, but this week I felt like I got whiplash. It went so fast. And yet today is Palm Sunday, where Jesus rode triumphantly into Jerusalem. Hosanna in the highest. So let's take a moment to settle our hearts and our focus and turn our eyes upon Jesus. The things of earth will grow.
what would it have been like to walk beside Jesus in Galilee or to eat dinner with the Master? Many people followed Jesus, listening to his words, his teachings, and were amazed at his works. But only 12 men were chosen to be trained under his direct guidance. These disciples experienced miracles, heard teachings, and watched the world change as Christ modeled before them a life of power and servanthood. Later, they would pattern their ministry after him, becoming true servants and beacons of hope. Little did they know the true impact they would have on the world for years to come by standing apart from the crowd and being a light in the darkness. Thomas suffered a cruel death. He was martyred by a pagan priest who thrust him through with a spear for his commitment to Christ. His courage was perhaps gained from his encounter with Christ in the upper room when he did not believe it was really Christ. James went out to preach until Herod Agrippa I ordered him killed in AD 44. On the way to his execution, his accuser was so overwhelmed by the extraordinary courage of James that he fell at the apostles' feet, asked for forgiveness, and accepted Christ as his Savior. Then he was taken and beheaded along with the Apostle James. Philip and Peter were faithful in their presentation of the gospel. Philip was beaten, thrown in prison, taken out, and pierced through the thighs. And then, like Peter, they both were crucified upside down. Peter insisted on this death because he felt he was not worthy to die the same way Jesus did. The apostles suffered cruel deaths. Among those beaten, stoned, stabbed with spears, and skinned alive were James the Less, Matthew, and Bartholomew. James was stoned before having his brains dashed out with a blacksmith hammer. Matthew was slain with a halberd, which is a spear-like battle axe. Bartholomew was cruelly beaten and then flayed alive with knives. These men willingly paid an awesome price to spread the good news. Andrew, Thaddeus, and Simon were crucified on a cross. Simon's cross was fixed into the ground to form an X-shaped cross. Each of them ministered to the world in different nations. Andrew preached in the Asiatic nations. Thaddeus went to evangelize Syria and Persia. Simon zealously ministered across North Africa, then across Europe and into Britain. These men were committed to spread the gospel around the world, no matter what the cost. John went on to establish churches in Asia Minor, as well as write the Gospel of John and three epistles. He was exiled on the Isle of Patmos, where he wrote the book of Revelation. His enemies tried to boil him in oil, but he miraculously escaped. About 100 AD, John died, the only one of the 11 apostles to die of natural causes. Judas went out to finish betraying his Lord, but when he realized what he had done, he was so overwhelmed by guilt and shame that he went out and hanged himself. Jesus went out to the Garden of Gethsemane to agonize in prayer and to await being betrayed by a kiss from one of his own apostles. He would be arrested, tried, crucified, and buried in a sealed tomb. But on the third day, he arose from the dead. Jesus went out and finished the work of redemption he came to earth to do. All these men went out, and as the Bible says, they turned the world upside down. Simon Peter came from Bethsaida. He was a fisherman at Capernaum on the Sea of Galilee. He had the reputation of being rough and impulsive, up one day and down the next. However, Jesus saw the good qualities and strengths in Simon, so Jesus renamed him Peter, meaning rock. But before the night is over, Peter, the rock, will forsake and deny Jesus three times. John was also from Bethsaida and a fisherman from Capernaum. He and his brother James were ambitious and fiery individuals who showed such impatience at times that Jesus called them the sons of thunder. John had a tender side that earned him the name John the Beloved. Throughout this long night and into tomorrow, he will follow Jesus from afar, but at the foot of the cross, he will care for Mary, the mother of Jesus. James, the brother of John, was one of the first disciples to join Jesus and sometimes called James the Greater to distinguish himself from James the Less. He, John, and Peter were part of the inner circle. He witnessed the transfiguration of Jesus, but before the night is over, he will fall asleep in the Garden of Gethsemane while Jesus agonizes in prayer. At that moment, James will give in to fear and forsake Jesus. Andrew was also one of the first to follow Jesus. He modeled how to serve the Lord. The first thing he did after meeting Jesus was to bring his brother Simon to meet Jesus. Like his brother Simon Peter, Andrew left his fishing nets to become a fisher of men. Philip, the apostle with a Greek name, was from the Greek community of Bethsaida. He was plain, matter-of-fact, and sometimes questioning. Going against his upbringing, he gave up the worldliness of his Greek culture to follow Jesus. Philip's friend Bartholomew, son of Ptolemy, sometimes called Nathanael, was from Cana of Galilee. This was the same place where Jesus did his first miracle of turning water into wine. At first, he did not believe the Messiah could possibly come out of Nazareth, but then he met Jesus. Matthew, sometimes called Levi, was from Capernaum and was also one of the earliest followers of Jesus. He was a publican or tax collector, and after Jesus had called him, he invited many for a big feast so his fellow publicans could meet Jesus. Thomas was also called Didymus, a name meaning twin, although there is no record of his twin. He has been called Doubting Thomas because he did not believe that Jesus had indeed risen from the dead. He would later proclaim, "My Lord and my God," upon seeing him, and is considered one of the most loyal of all the apostles. James, son of Alphaeus, was sometimes called James the Less to distinguish him from James, son of Zebedee. He may have been younger than all the other apostles, but before it is all over, he will stand tall among the apostles. Thaddeus, also known as Levius or Jude, he shows special warmth of character and devotion to others, and once asked Jesus a question that Jesus answered by revealing his plan to send us another comforter, the Holy Spirit. Simon, the Canaanite or Zealot, was probably a member of the Zealots, a political party that plotted to overthrow the Roman government and reestablish an independent Jewish state. Always listed last in Scripture is Judas Iscariot. He was the treasurer of the group, even though other apostles called him a thief. He, more than any other, criticized Jesus. He always seemed to have his own hidden agenda. Even before arriving here, he had started his scheme to betray his Lord. And then there was Jesus. And when the hour had come, he sat down and the 12 apostles with him.
The kingdom is open. There's room at the table for someone like you. The king has been hoping and searching for someone to show all his kindness and favor to. The kingdom is open. I don't know what they've told you. I don't know what you've heard. There's a place where the broken find hope and a love that you don't have to earn. Oh, it's a place where you've always belonged. A place where you're so unashamedly loved. There's a king who's so ready to welcome you home. And he's closer than you'll ever know.
I do not speak concerning all of you, for I know whom I have chosen, but that the scripture may be fulfilled. He who eats bread with me has lifted his heel against me. Now I tell you this before it comes, so that when it comes to pass, you may believe that I am he. I say to you, one of you will betray me.
I am Andrew, brother to Simon Peter. I was the first to bring Peter to Jesus, and I found the little lad with the 5 loaves of bread and the 2 fish that day when Jesus fed the 5,000. When he began to feed so many with so little, I was glad. I had joy in my heart that I had decided to follow the Lord by being myself. He must have seen something in me to make me part of the 12 apostles. We shared many triumphs and tragedies together. I may not have been in the inner circle like Peter, but I was a true friend and companion to my Lord. I mean, what greater gift could life give a simple fisherman? than to be able to follow Jesus. So, I have to ask, how could he get away with this in his own heart? What is the condition of his heart? But what's the condition of my heart? Could it be me? Could it be Andrew? Is it I?
I am James, brother of John. I followed Jesus when he called us while we were mending our nets by the Sea of Galilee. I was with Jesus in the home of Jairus when he raised his little daughter from the sleep of death. And on the Mount of Transfiguration, I saw Jesus speaking with Moses and Elijah. Being so excited about this opportunity we had, that I had, of privilege and opportunity, I asked him last week, Lord, could I sit at your right hand and my brother on your left when we enter your kingdom? He said to us, are you able to drink the cup that we are to drink, that I am to drink? And I said, Lord, we are able. He then went on to tell us that he who would be first among us must be last. And he demonstrated that by washing our feet just before supper. He taught us that God's way was one of love. And now he who taught us this way of love is to be betrayed by one of us? Who would do such a thing? Who would? And yet I can't help but thinking, in my desire for privilege and opportunity and power, could I unknowingly betray my Lord? Lord, is it I, James?
My name is Matthew, and I was a tax collector at the gates of Jerusalem. When Jesus came to me and said, follow me, I had mixed emotions, for I was a very important man. To follow Jesus meant losing all my prestige and worldly possessions. I knew that nothing would ever be the same again if I followed Jesus. But my heart longed for something that only he could fill. When Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest, all the confusion and unrest of my soul left. Now once again, my heart became disturbed when Jesus said someone is going to betray him. Could it be me, Matthew? Lord, is it I? Is it I?
My name is Philip. Several friends and I were in Bethany listening to John the Baptist. It was there that Jesus called us to become his disciples. During this time of close fellowship with Jesus, my love for God became stronger and stronger. In fact, I remember so well before he fed the 5,000, asking Jesus and many others, where are we to buy enough bread so that all could eat? Little did I know that Andrew was already bringing a little boy's lunch to Jesus. When Jesus began to tell us that God was our Heavenly Father, it was almost beyond my understanding. But as I listened to his words, I understood very well. In fact, I can almost say that he who has seen Jesus has seen the Father. But it's very shocking that to learn that somebody is a betrayer amidst us. Does that traitor not know that by betraying Jesus, he also betrays God? Can one of our group be so blind? Could it be Philip? Lord, is it I?
I am Thomas. Many of you think of me as a doubter. Deep down, I know that I'm not. It's just that usually I demand proof before I can believe. I remember when Mary and Martha came to send Jesus the word that their brother Lazarus had died. Some of the other apostles, they didn't want to go. They knew that the opposition was growing against Jesus. But I stood up. I said, let us go with him. May we die with him. So how is it that you always remember my doubt, but you forget Galilee? The healing of the sick, the curing of the diseased, opening the eyes of the blind, unstopping the ears of the deaf, and cleansing the lepers, and preaching to the poor. Yet opposition continues to build, and Jesus' enemies are determined to defeat him. As we talk, Jesus says that one of us, chosen 12, will betray him, be a traitor. But is it I?
I am John. Jesus called me to follow him when I was mending fishing nets with my father Zebedee and my brother James. What a wonderful change in my life since I met Jesus. He taught me that love is the key to life, and that is true. For it is love, God's wonderful love, that caused me to follow Jesus. And after that love had touched my life, I suddenly realized that Jesus came to live and die that I, John, might have eternal life. Oh, but I still have to ask, is it I?
Is it I, Lord?
I am called James the Less. I shall never forget the day I first saw the Master. I was passing down the road near the place where John was baptizing. I was curious. So I turned aside for a closer look. I saw Jesus asking John to baptize him. After John had baptized the Lord, the heavens opened and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in the form of a dove. We heard a voice from heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased." From the moment Jesus called me to follow him, I have been a devoted disciple. But now, one of us is to betray him? Surely it is madness to think that this could be true. Surely the betrayer is out of his mind. And yet, I ask myself, is it I, Lord?
I am Thaddeus. Jesus chose 12 of us to be the cornerstones of a new kingdom. Just as the 12 tribes of Israel were chosen to be the cornerstones of the old Jewish kingdom. I remember after Jesus praying that night that he called us to him and he gave us power over unclean spirits and told us to go forth and praise and declare that the kingdom of God is at hand. I was there in Jerusalem when he gave the great invitation. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Now Jesus, the man who would lighten all of our burdens, has this thrust upon him. Who could the traitor be? Who is the one that will betray Jesus? Could we all betray Jesus? Is it Peter? Is it James? Or John? Is it I, Lord?
Is it I?
I'm Nathaniel. And like some of these, I also am a fisherman. I was a disciple of John the Baptizer. So my friend Philip came to me one day, and he said, "We've found the very one Moses and the law and the prophets wrote. We found him in Nazareth. And I said, Nazareth? Can any good thing come out of Nazareth? You see, I didn't understand. Nazareth was such a little insignificant place. Why would God place his anointed there? But that's what he was saying. So Philip just said, come and see. So when Jesus saw me, he said, here is a true Israelite, one of no guile. But I had to ask him, how do you know me? Well, before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, he wasn't there. How could he know? So that's all I needed. I believed. But now my Lord is telling us that one of us is going to betray him. I don't understand this. How could anybody betray God's anointed? It doesn't make any sense to me. But he's saying that's what's going to happen. I mean, Jesus just knows things. I wonder, is it me? Is it I?
I'm Simon, the zealot. Before Jesus called me, I belonged to a group of hot-headed, bloodthirsty revolutionaries known as the zealots. We were all for armed rebellion against Rome and the reestablishment of King David's glorious kingdom of Israel. Jesus also told us of another kingdom, the kingdom of the human heart, where Jesus reigns supremely. Since then, he has shown me that the conquest of the heart is the only true, sincere, and lasting conquest. I've completely surrendered myself to him. But this surrender has not left me imprisoned. Rather, for the first time in my life, I'm free. I'm not afraid of Rome any longer. Sure, she's mighty, but God is almighty. Now the Master says that there's a spiritual Roman among us, one who would attempt by force what can only be conquered by love. Who can he be? Matthew, the publican? The big fisherman or his brother? Or being a former zealot, does he suspect me? Is it I? Is it I?
The Master has said that one of us will betray him. Was he referring to me when he said one of us will betray him? If I knew who the scoundrel was, I would pierce his heart and cut his tongue out with my dagger. Maybe it's my heart that I would have to pierce. He asked me three times, Peter, do you love me? I was hurt that he kept asking so much. I replied, Father, you know all things. You know I love you. Yet one of us will betray him. I'll say it again. I love you, Father. Yet I keep wondering, is it I?
All the others are from Galilee, but I am from a small town in Corinth in Judea. Hence, my name is Judas Iscariot. The others had confidence in me. They elected me to be their treasurer. And despite what all you others say behind my back about my impatience, stinginess, and ambition, Jesus believed in me too. Otherwise, he would have chosen someone else in my place. And now they say that I'm using these funds for my own personal use? Of course I was upset when Mary washed his feet with that expensive ointment and perfume. I still think it was a waste of money. And I think that if I've conspired with chief priests, and I have 30 pieces of silver on my belt, that's my affairs, not yours. And now they remind me that when Jesus was referring to me when he said, did I choose you 12? And one of you is the devil. I believe in you, Jesus. I believe in you. But someone had to make a move, and I made mine. Trust me. I feel your condemnation, your hatred, your judgment. But how convicting do I have to be to convict you? How many times have you seen a miracle with your own eyes, and only moments later you pass it off as a coincidence? Never happened. And you call Thomas the denier. How many times has Jesus given you an opportunity to share his love and truth with someone? But instead, you say nothing. You cower and you freeze. And you label Peter the denier guilty. How often do we think that we know what's best, how to spend our time and money, and consider it a tithe? It's not a tithe! And you call me the thief? Father, I figured it out. They're guilty. They betrayed you. I've betrayed you. What am I supposed to do? Can I admit? Or like all the others, should I piously, self-righteously ask myself, is it I? Is it I?
He who dips his hand in the dish with me will betray me. Now the Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to the man whom the Son of Man is betrayed.
Who is it, Lord?
To whom I shall give a piece of bread after I've dipped it. What you do it quickly. Now the Son of Man is glorified, and God is glorified. I give to you this new commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. For then the world will know that you are my disciples when you share this love with one another.
Thank you.
tonight was a time of reflection between Jesus and his disciples. Today is Palm Sunday. It's the day Jesus triumphantly rode into the holy city of Jerusalem, surrounded by his disciples in the center of their universe. See, Jesus came to Jerusalem proclaiming that he was the Messiah. This is significant because this was the first time in his public life that he had declared to everybody that he was the Messiah. But somehow they knew that. Because when he rode in Jerusalem, they were there to lay down palm branches before Jesus. And that's significant because palm branches in the kingdom of David were significant as a sign of royalty and victory. And Jesus was coming to Jerusalem in victory. But even beyond that, they laid down their cloaks in front of him. The cloaks that signified that he was the King of Kings. See, these just weren't any natural and ordinary garments. These were something special to them. They were the inner garments, the seamless garments where they tied tassels to the four corners. And these tassels represented the 613 commands of God. So when they laid down their cloaks in front of Jesus and Jesus came in over them, they were signifying that he is God. He is the Messiah. And they cried out for the whole world to hear, Hosanna, Hosanna to the King of David, Hosanna in the highest. Such that everybody heard. Everybody rejoiced, except for the Pharisees. See, they had realized that they couldn't stop him. They had realized that they couldn't contain him. They realized that they had lost. Jesus came in. And in coming into that holy city, he began his holy week. A week where Jesus would do so much more work, leading so many and teaching so many others to be betrayed. Betrayed by one of those he would count as one of his closest friends. But Jesus knew what he was doing. And in that time, he knew what had to be done. And Jesus, sacrificing himself, went to the cross for our sins. So that we would be washed clean. We would become somebody new. That we could be reconciled to the Father. And that death was defeated. But before doing that, Jesus shared a very intimate moment with his disciples. A moment of reflection, a moment of teaching, and a moment of a new covenant. Jesus did that. And it's something that we recognize to this very day. And we know that Jesus is our Savior. And he is the one that we praise and we worship and we proclaim to everybody that he is Lord, Prince of Princes, King of Kings. Now, as Jesus and his disciples left that day, singing a hymn and celebrating the occasion, Would you please stand with me? And we will close with a hymn.
Oh, I will be closing us in prayer. On the way out, you're going to be seeing a number of different baskets, at which point you put the money in there and it goes for the West Lyon Backpack Program. And then please join us for a time of fellowship. There's food and coffee and drinks, and you can also obviously feel free to thank the brothers who spoke. They'll be easy to pick out. They're kind of wearing costumes that are a little different from the rest of us. So let's go to our God in prayer. And Father, we do thank and praise you for this opportunity to be together. Father, we thank you for the different congregations within this town, as well as those from Brandon who came out to help us. Father, we ask that you would bless that church and their work this Holy Week. And Father, all the congregations within this community, we ask that you be with us now as we enjoy fellowship with one another and keep us safe on our homeward way. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. And you may go in peace.